Greetings, brothers and sisters. Greetings, brothers and sisters. I pray all is well with you and your families. I pray that you know that the grace of our Lord, that the grace of our Lord and Savior Christ Jesus is with us. And I just pray that you know that we can be encouraged in all things, okay? I pray that you know He would keep us, He would guide us, and He would lead us in all things, brothers and sisters, okay? But I got a word for you today, brothers and sisters. It's a heavy word. But before we get into the word of the Lord today, let us pray so our heart to get into a place to receive all that the Lord has to pour into us today, okay? So without further ado, brothers and sisters, let's pray. Dear Heavenly Wise Father, we repent of our sins. Please forgive us of our sin. We come before your throne. We draw to you right now in this moment. Holy Spirit, we pray that you would have your way. We pray that you would speak to us. We pray that you would lead us. We pray that you would guide us, Lord. Pray that you would give us a revelation of who you are. Holy Spirit, clear out every distraction, anything that would cause your word to be unfruitful, Lord. And we pray, Lord, that you would just refresh us and lead us by the righteousness that comes from your Spirit, Lord. Help us to seek you more. Help us to love you more. Help us to do your will. So, Holy Spirit, we welcome you. Saturate us, Lord, and give us life today. In Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen. 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 Well, brothers and sisters, I got a word for you today. It's a heavy meal, but it's definitely needed, brothers and sisters. It's a heavy meal, but it's definitely needed, brothers and sisters, okay? So, without further ado, my brothers and sisters, without further ado, let us get into this word, okay? Now, I've been spending time with the Lord, and as I've been spending time with the Lord, the Lord has been speaking to me in regards to his return and in regards to his heart. And brothers and sisters, there's a lot of things in this life that seem certain, but it's not really certain. There's a lot of things in this life that we can depend on, but in reality, we can't depend on. And sometimes we can fall into a place of where sometimes we won't trust nobody else or depend on nobody else, but we'll depend on ourselves. But the truth of the matter is that God said it is not wise for man to lean on his own understanding. That means we can't even depend on ourselves to walk into life and walk into righteousness, but we have to depend on every word that come from the mouth of God, man. And as I was on the way to the airport the other day to pick a family member up from the airport, the Lord began to speak to me heavily. Because whenever you're going to pick someone up from the airport, there are arrivals and there are departures. Whenever you go to pick someone up from the airport, there are arrivals and there are departures. Departure are those who are going out, and arrival of that which is coming in. And the Lord says, son, in this hour, I am moving things out and I am allowing for things to come in. That I am moving things out and I am allowing for things to come in. And the Lord said, on the flip side, you got to also know that the fight is not against flesh and blood, but against evil principalities of darkness in high places. So there are darkness that is going out, meaning going out into all of the earth. And there's darkness that are invading the land, even people pressing their heart, if they are not baptized in my spirit, Jesus. And the Lord says, son, well, whenever someone want to go into a far place, a far and distant country, then they have to fly on a plane to get there. That there are some places that you can hop in your vehicle to drive, but there are some places that requires a plane for you to travel because the distance is so great. Well, sin created a great distance between us and God. Sin created a distance, a great distance between us and God. Even though he was right there beside us the whole time, but sin created a great distance where we could not connect with him in his presence in the spirit. But Christ Jesus is that plane that helped us cross that border of sin by redeeming us through his blood and his sacrifice, that we are able to fly in the presence of God, even eternal life. And the Lord says, son, I got even another things that are happening in this hour, which is my second coming, and every man want to abort that plane. That my second coming is near. That my second coming is a few years away. And it's time for this world to repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. And it's time for America to repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. He said, speak this to my church. The title of this message is Flight 316, Free from Fatal Attraction and Uncertain Circumstance. The title of this message is Flight 316, Free from Fatal Attraction and Uncertain Circumstance. Well, whenever you buy a plane ticket, they give you a boarding pass. Whenever you buy a plane ticket, they give you a boarding pass with the boarding number of the flight that you're about to enter. Well, brothers and sisters, we are in a different hour. We are in the end times. We are in a different hour than we are in. And in this hour, you want to be on flight 316. In this hour, you want to be on flight 316. Because everything that have conformed to this world and everything that is in this world will be consumed by the turbulence that's going to happen in this hour. Now, whenever you are on a plane, you will feel the turbulence of a plane. But based upon the leadership of the pilot, the plane can handle the turbulence and land safely. Well, Christ Jesus is the pilot of flight 316. And whoever's on that flight in this hour, though it will be turbulence, they won't have to be afraid of the turbulence or the things that will happen during the flight, because their soul is safe in his hand. That on this flight, it won't mean that there will be no turbulence, but as you are on the plane with this pilot, you are guaranteed to land the right way. Okay. Now, one thing about an airport, there are many different pilots at an airport. One thing about an airport, there are many different pilots at an airport. But just because there are many different pilots at an airport don't mean every pilot have your best interest at heart. Just because there are many pilots at the airport, many destinations at the airport, that don't mean every pilot have your best interest at heart. And every destination at the airport does not mean it's the right destination for you to go to. Because if you don't look at your boarding pass and have the right boarding pass, then you can end up on the wrong plane. If you don't pay attention to your boarding pass and watch the flight number, you can end up on the wrong plane. Well, brothers and sisters, in this hour, this world is the wrong plane. And if you're not watching the right flight number, what is the right flight number? The gospel. The salvation of our Lord and Savior Christ Jesus. If you're not in salvation, then you are on the wrong plane. Because the right plane is flight 316. And that number 316 represents John 3:16, that God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son, that he gave his only begotten son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. That means if you're not on flight 316, then you will perish because you are going to the wrong destination. That everything that is not on flight 316 will perish, because everything that is not on flight 316 is a fatal attraction. Everything that is not on flight 316 leads to a fatal attraction. Okay? So let's break down a fatal attraction. Okay? Well, what is a fatal attraction? Well, a fatal attraction is something that attracts you, but it's fatal to your health. That can be a poisonous food. That can be a poisonous person. One thing about fatal attraction is that the attraction is what makes it fatal. The attraction is what makes it fatal, because you can have a good attraction and a wrong attraction. A good attraction is the gospel, because if you are attracted to the gospel, then the gospel will attract you to eternal life. But if you have the wrong attraction, which is this world, then it will attract you to everything that will cause you to die. Man, what else can we apply under fatal attraction to? We can apply fatal attraction to a stalker relationship, okay? A fatal attraction can be someone that is watching you, that is stalking you. Know that you have no interest in them, but because they are so obsessive to the attraction, they pursue that thing that even don't want them. They pursue that thing that even that don't want them. And because they can't get it, they try to take it by force. Now, though the attraction might not be to that person, but the person that is pursuing it, it is attraction to that person, and it making it fatal to the person on the receiving end, even though they're not seeking. And what caused it to be faithful is when that person that is pursuing begin to seek it by means of destruction or to bring death or harm to the other person. Well, brothers and sisters, this world is the same way. This world is like a fatal attraction. It looks at us even when we're not seeking it. It pursues us even when we're not seeking it. And it try to bring our soul into it to make us die. So if this world is full of lust, try to seek us when we're not seeking it, and it try to make us die, how much more will it make us die when we're pursuing it with our own free will? If this world try to attract us and seek us with fatal attraction, how much more will it cause us to die if we're pursuing it from the intimate place of our heart? Jesus. Therefore, let us seek and pursue flight 16. Let us seek the gospel and be transformed by the gospel, that we may overcome the fatal attraction of this world. Because not only do this world have fatal attraction, but this world have uncertain circumstances. Not only do this world have fatal attraction, but it also has uncertain circumstances. And as we look in this hour right now, brother and sister, we can see a lot of uncertain circumstances happen around us, but there's only one circumstance that is certain. There's a lot of circumstance that has happened around us, but there's only one that is certain. That is flight 316. What is flight 316? It is the gospel. The testimony of Christ Jesus is the only thing that is certain in this hour, because salvation will never fail you. The job will fail you. The money will fail you. The solution that man are given in this hour will fail you. But there's only one thing that will never fail. That is salvation. And let every man take heed to this call right now in this hour, so he can make sure he on flight 316. Because everything that is not on flight 16 will crumble. Make sure everyone is in salvation, because everything that is not a part of salvation will perish. Okay? Brothers and sisters, in this hour, there is many things that will happen in this hour through the one world government. Okay? Right now, I appeal to you, there are many things happening this hour through the one world government. They are issuing many agendas to push people forward into a cashless society, to push people more into a digital identity, to push people more into a situation where they will turn to themselves instead of turn to God, where they will look for man and turn to man for the solution instead of turning to the Almighty God who have given himself away for the soul of man. Therefore, brothers and sisters, let us take heed and seek the Lord Christ Jesus in this hour and make sure we are in salvation, because in the next few years, this world is going to go haywire. And the only peace and the only hope and the only truth will be in your salvation. And it's time for us to stop looking at salvation as a mediocre thing, but look at salvation as a priority thing. That in this hour, there is nothing will save you, but the only thing that will save you is the sacrifice of Christ Jesus, our Lord and Savior. Now, many of the politicians, the socialists, the communists in America and all around the world will try to give you man-made solutions of climate change and many other things talking about to save us. But I'm going to be honest, brothers, the only thing that will save you in this hour is your relationship with Jesus. The only thing that will save you in this hour is your relationship with Jesus. Self-righteousness won't save you in this hour. Only the righteousness of Christ Jesus, our Lord and Savior. Therefore, it's time for us to repent. The kingdom of heaven is at hand. And as I was spending time with the Lord said, Son, my church can do all things through me who give them strength. And the only strength that you're going to have in this hour is your salvation. Oh, and the Lord spoke to me. He said, Son, go to the book of Mark 7:14. Chapter 7, verse 14. Mark chapter 7, verse 14 says, let's start at verse 13. Making it, Jesus talking to the Pharisees. And he was talking about how because of the tradition of men, they made the word of God none effect. Okay. So verse 13, it said, verse 12, and you suffer him no more do out for his father or his mother, making the word of God of none effect through your traditions, which ye have delivered, and many such like things do ye. And when he had called all the people unto him, he said unto them, hearken unto every one of you, and understand me. Now notice the tradition of men were making the word of God none effect in those times. But it is also prophesied since today. Because many of us claim to be spiritual, we claim to have our own traditions of ancestors and different stuff like that. Jesus said, hearken unto me, every one of you. That anything that is outside of the Holy Spirit of God is false, because the only thing that is truth is Christ Jesus, our Lord and Savior Christ Jesus. And that truth is revealed by the Holy Spirit. Now speaking directly to the church, that our traditions and the things that we've done that led us to self-righteousness won't get us into eternal life, but only the salvation that he has given us through his sacrifice. Because the only thing that will keep us in it is our is when the word of God is having effect on our life. That we cannot be like the Pharisees based upon tradition, make the word of God an effect, but rather live by the Spirit of God, that the word of God may be revealed to us in truth and have an effect on our life, and it will show by the way we live through his sacrifice. Because how we live through his sacrifice in this hour shows that our name is written in the Lamb Book of Life. And as it is written in the Lamb Book of Life, when this one world government issued the mark of the beast, we won't be deceived, but rather we will endure to the end. And Jesus said, and when he had called all the people unto him, he said, hearken unto me, and one of you, and understand. There's nothing from without a man, and entering into him can defy him, but the things which come out of him, those that would defy him. Brothers and sisters, in this hour, brothers and sisters, there's many things that have gone out through false prophets, through the media, that would try to defile us. Okay? What goes in won't defile us. Let me phrase that. Jesus was talking about how they were talking about the traditional washing. They was rebuking people, the Pharisees were rebuking people because they did not wash your hand. But Jesus was saying, it ain't the unwashed hand ain't what defile you, but it what comes out of the heart would defile you. brothers and sisters, we have to be careful and guard the gates of our ears and what we hear and what we receive in this hour, because what goes out, what defiles us. Okay? So what goes into our mind, what goes into our heart, if it's not guarded by the Spirit of God, what comes out would defile us, because we were not rooted in His Word. Because being rooted in the Word of God is a spiritual filter that cleanses our soul from all unrighteousness. And He deciphered the information that we receive. Okay? And the Lord said, hear what the Holy Spirit is saying to the churches. Hearken to the word of the Lord in this hour, every one of you, because the only thing that will save you is Jesus. Brothers and sisters, in this hour, there will be nothing physical that will save you. Money won't save you. Matter of fact, the book of Revelation said that the rich people of this world, name them. You can name all of the rich people of this world. Soon, leading up to the second coming of Christ Jesus, all of them, when Jesus comes, they're going to be hiding. The same people that are being prideful, the one world government, the people that are attached, the globalists in this hour, the communists, the socialists, all of these people that want new world order, one world order that they have been working on. When Jesus comes in His second coming, the same people that are talking about His money and all of these things will be the same people that are hiding from Him in that great day. In the book of Revelation, they said they're going to be like, rock, hide us from Him who sit on the throne forever. You got to think, all this money they got, but they're going to be hiding in His second coming. Why? Because they're going to see that He is God and it was plain. Brothers and sisters, let that not be so amongst us, church, because brothers and sisters, the only thing, listen to me, brothers, let's hear what the Holy Spirit is saying to this church. The only thing that's going to save you in this hour is your salvation. The only thing that will save you in this hour is your salvation. Jesus is the only answer. And He is allowing these things to happen in this hour, and it's going to get worse. There's going to be a period of false peace, but it's going to get worse. God is our Lord and Savior is allowing it to happen in this hour. The Lord ain't causing these things, but He will allow these things to show you. The only thing that will get saved in this hour is your salvation. The judgment of God is upon this world, brothers. The judgment of God is upon this world. Here, what the Holy Spirit is saying to the church, there's a lot of false prophets saying a lot of things, but the hand of God is stretched out on earth. The judgment of His judgment is upon this world, brothers and sisters. Therefore, the only thing that will save us is salvation. So what do we say? Church, we don't have to be worried as long as we obey the gospel, because we know the gates of hell will not prevail against it. That we can have confidence in His word, and we can find peace in His word, because we know He loves us greatly, even to the death on the cross, okay? Then He took me to Mark chapter 7, verse 37, and this is what it said. It said, started verse 36, and He charged them that they should tell no man, but the more He charged them so much, the more a great deal they published it. And were beyond measure astonished, saying, He hath done all things well. He make both the deaf and hear and the dumb speak. Brothers and sisters, we have an understanding in this hour. There are people that are spiritually spirit, they are physically deaf, but there are also some of us who are spiritually deaf. Let us turn from the hardness of our heart and let our ears perker up in this hour to hear what the Holy Spirit is saying to the churches. Okay? Because so as Jesus made the deaf physically hear, in the lame walk, so can He bring us from a spiritual deaf into a spiritual awakening. And bring us alive from the dead, that we may hear the call of salvation and the wisdom that is poured out from His heart. Jesus, man. Okay? Why? The Lord said, hearken unto me, every one of you. For Jesus said, if I can make the physical death and dead come to life, so shall I can make the spiritual dead and lame come to life by them humbling themselves in my presence. Jesus, man. And then the Lord took me to Mark 8:4. It said, and His disciples answered, from whence came a man satisfy these men with bread in the wilderness? So let's go to verse 8, Mark 8:1. In those days the multitude being very great and having nothing to eat, Jesus called His disciples unto Him and said unto them, I have compassion on the multitude, because they have now been with me 3 days and have nothing to eat. And if I send them away fastened to their own house, they will faint by the way, for the diverse of them came from afar. Now look at the compassion of the Lord, of how He seen them come at a great distance, but He wanted to feed them because of their suffering. He wanted to feed them because they have came a great distance. Church, in this hour we will face persecution. But the same way Jesus had passion on them in the wilderness because they had a great distance, so will our Lord and Savior Christ Jesus have compassion on us when we're walking through this wilderness. Therefore, he will make provision and take care of us in this hour. And we don't have to fear because the great gates of hell will never prevail against his church. Therefore, we can be radical and victorious in this hour, even in a troubled time. Okay? Now, verse 4 said, and his disciple answered him, from whence can a man satisfy these men with great bread here in this wilderness? And he asked them, how many loaves have you? And they said, 7. He commanded the people to sit down on the ground, and he took the 7 loaves and gave thanks and break bread and gave to his disciples to set before them. And they did set them before the people. Okay? And they had a few small fishes, and he blessed and commanded to set them also before them. So they did eat and were filled, and they took up the broken meat that was left in 7 baskets. Oh man. Now his disciples said, how can we take this little bread and feed it among so many in such a great wilderness? Brothers and sisters, in this hour we are in a great wilderness, and the Lord will not only provide for us physically in this hour, but even if he did not, we're still going to serve him because he did everything on the cross for us. That if he do not one other thing, he did enough on the cross. Okay? And secondly, notice that his disciple asked him, how can we provide for someone in such a great wilderness? Okay? Now notice that they had a little, but it went a great distance by the hand of God. Notice that it was a little, but it went a great distance by the hand of God. Okay? Because the bread of Jesus right here was showing us not, but he was giving us a teaching right here that he did. So from this physical thing that happened amongst the disciples and the multitude of the people, also can show how the spiritual bread is from the kingdom of God. And this spiritual bread is what we're going to need in this hour. That the physical thing of this world is not going to carry us in this hour, but only this spiritual bread, that manna that comes from heaven. And that bread is Christ Jesus, our Lord and Savior, the bread of life. Notice that they had a physical bread, but the physical things that they had seemed impossible. It was like, man, there's so many people. Like, how are we going to feed these people with just this little bit, this physical bread we have? But Jesus lifted up that physical bread to heaven, and God made it multiply that bread so it can feed all. And the physical bread could not go further unless the hand of God touched it. Church, let us not lean on our own wisdom in this hour and trust the hand of God to multiply our testimony. Meaning, let us trust in the hand of God to multiply his testimony in our heart, that testimony may multiply fruits of righteousness in our memories, but that we may live righteousness for him and towards him, and also that righteousness be multiplied upon the other that surround us in his kingdom. That we will bring others into his kingdom, okay? But not only that, brothers and sisters, the Lord also was showing us that the physical bread of this life is not like the kingdom, not like the bread that comes from heaven, Jesus. And the Lord said, son, let the bread that comes from heaven satisfy us in this wilderness, in this hour. For the bread of heaven goes further, even eternal life. Then notice that when Jesus stuck the bread up toward heaven, it multiplied. And the Lord says, son, let my bread satisfy your soul in this hour, because my bread multiply your heart even into eternal life. That my bread multiply righteousness in your heart, and that righteousness will lead even into eternal life. The Lord said, let the bread that come from heaven satisfy your soul in this wilderness, in this hour, for the bread of heaven goes a lot further, even eternal life, versus the bread that comes from man that will perish because it has no life in it. Because only life is found in my bread, says the Lord Christ Jesus, our Lord and Savior. And then he took me to Mark 8, verse 38. Okay? And this is what our Lord and Savior Christ Jesus said in Mark 8, verse 38. Whosoever there shall be ashamed of me and of my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of him all shall the Son of Man be ashamed when he cometh in his glory of his Father with his holy angels. And the Lord has been speaking to me that in this hour, church, we have to have a great boldness and not be ashamed of his testimony. Because right here in this text, in Mark 8:38, it is also prophecy. That he was not only talking about a daily living, but he also was talking about the end time. Because as we walk in this way, not being ashamed daily, in our daily living, being bold, it also would keep us in this hour that is going to happen in the next few years when they sign this peace agreement that will begin to find the seven to his return. Okay. When Jesus said, "If you deny me before man, then I'm going to deny you before my Father in heaven." Brother and sister, in this hour, this whole world is going to be gripped by one world government and the Antichrist. Okay. And this hour, we're going to have to make a stand. Okay. We're going to have to make a stand. Okay. And the Lord Jesus said, "If you deny me before man, then I would deny you before my Father in heaven. If you deny me before man, then I would deny you before my Father in heaven." Therefore, brothers and sisters, let every man take heed how he build on a testimony by allowing the Holy Spirit to lead us into the righteousness of God, that we may be sound in the faith, strong in the faith, rooted in the gospel, that we may be bold to proclaim his name and not deny him, even in times of trouble, in times of persecution. Because in this hour, this Jesus said, whosoever therefore shall be ashamed of me and my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of him also shall the Son of Man be ashamed. Brothers and sisters, right now we are living in a sinful, adulterous generation, a sinful, adulterous, rebellious generation. This is through the spirit of the Antichrist that is in this world right now. And if we be ashamed of him in this generation, church, also in this 5 to 7 year period, then when Jesus comes in his second coming, he will deny us before the Father, because we really did not love him from the heart, because we deny his name. Therefore, brothers and sisters, how do we don't deny his name? Not only from our lips can we deny his name, but we can deny our name. We can deny him by the way we live. So what do we say? What is going to happen in this hour? In this hour, there's going to be a time of one world religion with coexistence and interfaithals, where they're going to say it's going to be like the times of Babylon in the book of Daniel, where they say you can worship your own God long as you don't say that your God is greater than anybody else's God. That is what's going to happen in the next few years, brothers and sisters. In church, we can't play that way, because Jesus said, "I am the only way." So in this hour, in this adulterous and sinful generation, they're gonna lift up a statue of false religion. Okay. And what they're gonna say is, "Hey, you can believe in what you want to believe in, just don't exalt your God higher than everybody else's God." That is false, brothers and sisters. That is false, brothers and sisters. That is what is gonna happen, and it's out. Okay. So they're not gonna have a problem with you. Hear what I'm saying, brothers and sisters? They'll be okay with you saying, they'll be okay with you watering down Jesus, but they won't be okay with you making a stand for Jesus. Okay? Making a stand is not just saying, "I know and I believe on it." Because you can say, "Hey, I believe in Jesus. I know him." But when it comes to them saying, "Hey, is Jesus on the way to heaven?" You say no, then you just denied his name. If you said that I know Jesus and I believe in Jesus, but when they begin to ask you, "Is Jesus the only way to heaven? Do we all worship the same God?" And if you say yes, then you just deny Jesus. That is how they're going to make you deny the Lord in this hour. Some physically, but they're also going to try to do it cunningly to make you say that we all worship the same God. That's completely false. That's going to be a part of the system of the mark of the beast. Okay. So, brothers and sisters, hear what the Holy Spirit is saying to the churches. Be ready to make a stand in this hour, brothers and sisters. Because if you deny him before man in this adulterous sinful generation, so he deny you when he comes in his second coming. In the next few years, brothers and sisters, hear what the Holy Spirit is saying to the churches. Okay. Job chapter 18 said, Wrath come with the sword, so that you may know there's a judgment. The Lord right now got his hand stretched out to the earth, and there's a sword in the earth right now. Why? So he may know that there is a judgment for all there. So people may know that there is a judgment for all wickedness. That the sinful, okay, that the abominations of sin that is in the earth, from killing, murder, violence, homosexuality, all of these things that are happening are going up in the nostrils of God. And the sin, the wickedness of this world is crying out in his ears right now. And he got a mighty sword stretched out on the earth right now. Stretched out on the earth. His hand is stretched out. And he said to me, count down to the second coming of my son. He said, son, I'm not pulling back my sword. And even when my son comes, he's judging this world in his righteousness. Right now, God got a mighty sword in the earth right now so that they may know. He got a mighty sword against the earth right now so that people know that his wrath, so people may know by his wrath, there will be judgment. And here's the thing. That's not even his wrath. He's allowing his judgment to come upon the earth to know that there are wrath leading to his judgment, that his wrath is going to be the ultimate judgment for man. That is what is happening in this hour. And the only thing that would keep you is his salvation. Church, do we have to worry? No, the obedient church don't have to worry because we are in him and we're free from his judgment. But he have a sword in the earth right now that they may know. Wrath come with the sword so that you may know there is a judgment. Okay. So this world may know that wrath come with the sword. He got his sword in the earth right now. He's teaching people that wrath come with the sword. And to know that there is a judgment coming for all those who are unrighteous. Also, the global elitists in this world right now. Okay. Excuse me. Job chapter 20 says, treat your brother right. Love thy neighbor. Treat your brother right. Yeah. As I read Job chapter 20, it was foreshadowing me. And the Lord was speaking to me, foreshadowing me, speaking about even in the New Testament with Jesus said, love thy God with all thy heart, mind, body, soul, and love thy neighbor as thyself. Treat your brother right. Church, in this hour, brother and sister, let us not get entangled with the rioters and the things that are going on around this world because the globalists got an evil agenda. There's a lot of politicians, communists, socialists, progressives, and a lot of Democrats are socialists, are communists. Okay, so we're not gonna be biased. Republican or Democrat. We watching church. We watching Republican or Democrat. If they are socialists, if they are communists, brothers and sisters, it's time for us to preach the gospel because the only thing that's gonna save us is salvation. Let every man turn to the gospel, turn back to the feet of God, turn back to God, turn away from his rebellion, turn to the love of God that he may be saved, brothers and sisters. What the Holy Spirit is saying to the church, because the next few years, you're going to see the Lord's hand is mighty. And they will know that he is the Lord, okay? And the Lord says, son, in this hour, everything is going to go dark, and the only light is going to be in the church. Therefore, church, let us be obedient. An obedient bride. Let us love our God with all our heart, mind, body, and soul, and love our neighbor as thyself. Okay? Love thy neighbor as thyself, brother and sister. Let us treat our brother right and love thy neighbor as thyself. And pray. Let us pray for the leaders, whether they're Republican or Democrat church. Let us pray that they will come to repentance. Let us pray that they will come to receive salvation in our Lord because he wants them to come. Okay? Brothers and sisters, we have to be awakened in this hour, okay? And last but not least, the Lord said, Matthew 11:6, blessed is he that is not offended by me. Brothers and sisters, church, we got to raise up and be bold in this hour and stop being scared to offend people. Because the gospel itself is offensive. And sometimes we're so afraid of offending people that we'll deny the Lord who died for us. We're so afraid of offending people that we will end up denying the Lord who sacrificed himself for us. Okay. Jesus said, blessed is the man who is not offended by me. Church, and this church, and this goes out to America. Those who hear, those who have an ear, let them hear what the Spirit is saying, the Holy Spirit is saying to the church. Humble yourself. Let us humble ourselves and seek the face of God. Let us turn from our pride. Let us turn from thinking that we control our own life and we control our own destiny. Because COVID-19 got a way of showing us that we don't control our own destiny. Because many of us were planning a vacation to build an empire. And this shook the world and crumbled some of these things that we've been building. Why? Because a lot of us have been building empires, have not been seeking God, thinking we are in control of our lives. But God's saying, this is the hour of salvation. This is the hour of my second coming. Let every man take heed and turn to me. He said, blessed is the man that is not offended by me. What is he saying to us? The gospel is the only way. Let us not be offended by that gospel. He said, you have to repent and come to me and be saved, because that is the truth. And when he cracked that sky in the next few years, it's going to be a sad day for people who thought he was not real. And it's going to be a sad day for us who knew he was real, but instead we played church. We played around with church, but didn't take it serious. Brothers and sisters, time for us to repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. And let every man make sure he on flight 16. What is that flight? Salvation. Because in his salvation, he free us from the fate or attraction of this world. And he free us from the uncertainty of our circumstances. Because if we put trust in our circumstances, we're going to always be all over the place in our emotions, not knowing, worrying, struggling with fear and anxiety, all over the place. Because this life is uncertain. But there's only one thing that is guaranteed, that is certain. That is his word. And his word is salvation, because salvation because Christ Jesus is the word of God. Brothers and sisters, this is all I have for you. I pray that this word was a blessing to you. And I pray that it keep you and lead you to eternal life. If you have not accepted Christ Jesus as your Lord and Savior, repeat this prayer to me. Say, dear Lord, I repent of my sins. Please forgive me my sins. Thank you for leading me to this place. Fill up your spirit. Teach me to walk in your ways. I put my trust in you for salvation. I believe that you sent your one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. I accept Jesus Christ as my Lord, my risen Savior. Thank you for your grace, and thank you for your mercy. In Jesus Christ's name we pray. Amen. Amen. If you accept the Christ Jesus as your Lord and Savior, then the best thing you can ever do in your life. If you accept the Christ Jesus as your Lord and Savior, then the best thing you can ever do in your life. Now go get baptized in the name of Jesus Christ, the name of the Father, the name of the Son, the name of the Holy Spirit. And if something happens to you tomorrow, you're safe to get to the kingdom of heaven. Okay? Welcome to the kingdom of God, brothers and sisters. Because that's the only thing that will save us daily. In case we take our life, bro, but also in this hour in heaven in the next few years. Okay? What should our mindset be? We should rather have nothing in this life and be with Jesus than to have everything in this life and miss Jesus. Because true success is not having abundance of things in this life, but true success is being retrieved by the one who receives into life when he comes. Okay? Because I can have many degrees. I have degrees. I have many certifications. But guess what? I count it all out for the excellency of his glory. I've been to school, got many things, but I count it all lost for the excellency of his glory. That I have if I had a choice to choose between a degree and salvation, I'll leave everything, because that is eternal. Because we can have degrees and everything in this life. I'm not saying you can't do these things, but not let these things have your heart. Let not them have an item in your heart. Because you can have all of these things, and when he come, if you're going to go with him, then no matter how successful in this life it was, you failed because you did not fulfill your true duty, which is to live and obey God through the Spirit and in truth through the sacrifice of Christ Jesus, our Lord and Savior. But we can have none of these things. But when Jesus comes and we go to him, then we were a smashing success more than anybody that have a million degrees, because we fulfilled our true duty, which is to live and obey God from the heart, from the Spirit. Church, it's time for us to repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. The church, we're not waiting on the end time to get here, because the end is now. Yes, beloved. We're not waiting on the end time to get here, because the end is now. See you next time, brothers and sisters. Goodbye.